everybody. How are you today? Welcome. I'm Amanda Haas, and I'm a culinary ambassador for Whole Foods Market, and I am so excited to be here hosting this culinary stage all weekend long for the Napa Valley Film Festival. And I am so excited for this segment today because I think it's going to be my favorite food ever. And the film is going to be wonderful as well. So let's kick it off. I'd like to introduce you to Elizabeth Carroll, who's the filmmaker of Nothing Fancy, and we can watch a clip. Let's see.
Diana Kennedy's knowledge and passion for Mexican cooking is unsurpassed.
She's a legend.
Wow. She is a prophet for Mexican food.
Put it in context. I'm old, okay?
She was like an Indiana Jones of food, trying to search for that precious gem.
How do you express this recipe so that people can do it, so that it won't be lost?
She put on thousands of miles doing her research.
It's all been gentrified.
It's appalling. Mexico is importing chilies.
Read my books and learn, please.
What are you going to do when I'm gone? Who else is going to start screaming? I am 90, so everybody gets very nervous. And I'm not going to be around much longer. All my life, I've cooked. You just go on doing what you know you want to do. And you'll make your mark, or you may not.
What's life about if you can't make yourself heard?
Oh my gosh. It must be so exciting to see this come to life. Before we bring the chef out too, I just want to ask, you said it's playing at the, they'll turn it on for you. You said it's playing at the Archer tomorrow?
So we had our first screening today in St. Helena at the Cameo Cinema, which is an amazing theater if you guys have a chance to see any films there. It really is. It's like this beautiful renovated art house theater, and they have a Dolby Atmos system and like a 6K projector, and it's just the highest quality like viewing experience that you can have. So go see films at the Cameo. I'm plugging my friend.
but we want them to see yours tomorrow as well.
Yeah, so tomorrow, this film is going to play here in Napa at the Archer Hotel at noon.
Okay.
And I would love for you guys to come see it.
It's
the last screening here at the festival. So.
Okay. Well, we'll get to dig into it more, but I'm really excited that we have Chef Ignacio Beltran here, who is the executive chef of Gran Electrica. We've got a big, come on out, chef.
Woo-woo-woo.
He is going to cook. Hey, hey, chef. How are you?
Great, yourself?
This crowd is fun this afternoon. Yeah. Everyone's seen a movie or two, had some wine.
Yeah.
But I am really excited. I'm excited about this pairing of people, but also about the recipe that you're making. Mm-hmm. So what are you making for us today, or what did you make for them today?
We're going to be making a pipián con pato.
Okay.
That's going to be a dish as prehistoric as, or not prehistoric, pre-Hispanic.
Prehistoric, whatever.
dish that was one of Moctezuma's favorites, so.
Wow.
Yeah, and with that being said, with the Spaniards eating the dish, having it, not really knowing what this mole was.
Right.
They ended up calling it pipián due to the fact that the primary ingredient to this was what they called pepita, or the pumpkin.
The pumpkin seeds.
Yeah, the pumpkin seeds, yeah.
So, wow, I didn't know that.
Yeah,
and then where'd the mole come from then?
So the mole itself is the Aztec language Nahuatl. That's going to be translating into sauce.
Okay.
So it was a simple sauce, which was something for essentially any sauce that was created with a combination of chiles, seeds, nuts, and some fruit.
Okay.
They always kind of referred to it as mole.
Right.
So this was a great identifier for the Spaniards, for pipián itself.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then I love it because I know this much about Mexican cooking. It's one of my favorites. And we'll get into the beautiful story of Diana Kennedy and what she's done for the food as well. But what, as you start to make the mole, what is special about yours? And what do people do to change it and make it their own?
So, I mean, as far as the mole and the traditional sense of it, I've kept it for the most part, same ingredients, just balancing the flavors that are a little more modernized in the sense of how we're used to eating it. You know, then it was a little more coarser. Certain sauces are a little thicker.
Right.
So we're creating just kind of like this velvety kind of texture with a combination of the seeds with the duck. So.
Oh, I can't wait to try. And with the duck. I mean, what a pairing, right?
Yeah.
Speaking of, I want to ask Steve Greenberg, who's pouring wine for us today, too. What are we drinking with this?
Well, we're drinking a beautiful Carneros Pinot Noir. Very light, refreshing. A lot of pear, a little...
No, you're not. You're drinking Pinot Gris. Just kidding.
Pinot Gris.
Gotcha. we're going to see how that holds up.
A little pear, a little applesauce. Sorry about that. Stone fruit, maybe some peach and some lime essence to it. So.
Well, we'll see. I'll be curious as we get going, Chef, too. It would be, for me, it would be hard to pair wine with these spices because it's, I think, really strong notes of flavors, which I love, but I wouldn't even know where to start. So this is fun.
Yeah. So
okay,
I mean,
so let's get into it.
We'll go ahead and start.
We need this pan going. I'll be in charge of the Monogram induction cooktop. How hot would you like it?
Why don't we go 3/4 of the way?
Okay, we'll try that. And is this?
So this here is duck fat.
Duck fat.
We'll be utilizing to render out all our ingredients.
Okay. And as you make duck confit, you just keep saving fat, or how do you do that?
Yes. All right. It stores, not indefinitely, but you know, it was a form of preservation.
Exactly.
So it's a great kind of vessel.
In prehistoric times.
Exactly. It's a great vessel to have as far as things to have,
I shouldn't tease him. I don't know him.
No, you're fine.
It's not nice.
So
you're going to do the onions in the duck fat. I'm into this. Before, the whole thing?
Before we do that, actually.
You want to do the garlic?
Brown the garlic.
Okay.
Here. We'll do about half of that.
Okay. And then how much of the onion you'll have me add, like...
We'll do all of that.
Okay,
yeah, that'd be
great.
Perfect.
So you just want to get the onion kind of browned,
or
the garlic, I should
say. We'll brown it. Nice thing about with Mexican cuisine in general, we tend to char a lot of things. That's a natural flavor. Char, wood, mesquite, like those flavors of smoke.
Right.
Those are things that you're really looking for in a lot of just kind of Mexican cuisine in general. We'll turn this guy.
Yeah, we can turn that one on too. Oh, look at you. Okay.
And so with that being said, we're going to go ahead and char our garlic to kind of give it this nice pungent aroma, but it'll mellow it out. We won't blacken it to where it gets bitter.
Okay.
So
I would take it farther than I would be used to doing.
Yes.
Right?
Just a little bit.
Just a little bit. Okay. And then we'll add the onions once this looks a little bit dark.
Yeah, we'll sweat it out.
Okay. Can you tell I'm excited to cook? I haven't been cooking much while I've been here. I've just been talking, so I'm like, give me a job.
Yeah. And so while that's going, we're going to go ahead and toast some of our chiles.
Okay.
We've got three here. We've got the morita, guajillo, as well as ancho. Good thing about the chiles, they're adding a little different notes as well as body and spice factors to the actual food itself. For instance, these guys, the guajillos, they're going to be a little citrusy, slighter, kind of like a nutty, if you will, once it gets toasted. This pasilla is going to be more like a prune. Kind of that sweet kind of flavor. And the morita is going to add just that citrusy spice that we're kind of looking for.
Oh, this is smoking. Is that a little too hot?
Too hot.
And how's my garlic?
That is great.
We'll time to add the onion?
Yeah, perfect.
Okay, terrific. So did you settle upon those three chilies as just your favorite, or is that a pretty typical combination?
These are very typical in the sense of, like I was commenting with the body, as well as the heat factor and... the nuttiness that is being added.
Right.
That's pretty typical. While you're doing that.
Well, I'm sauteing my onion.
Yeah, I'm going to go ahead and seed some of these guys out.
Okay, terrific.
And we're going to start toasting them.
Great. I wanted to ask Elizabeth, too. I'm familiar with Diana Kennedy. I don't know if you are, who's the subject of her film. She has led a remarkable life. But will you share a little bit about how you came to do this film?
Sure. You know, I had spent a really minimal amount of time in Mexico at the point at which I became connected with Diana Kennedy, but I knew I really wanted to go back, and I wanted to talk about and explore the kind of matriarchy of passing down food culture and passing down recipes between women. You know, it's like it's a female responsibility largely. Mm-hmm. Thankfully, there are amazing chefs like Ignacio who, you know, we just met, but hopefully...
We're assuming.
Hopefully I can learn more about your story and understand kind of like how recipes were passed down to you. I assume that like, right. You know, you're maybe your grandmother or your mother, there's a matriarchy involved in sort of how especially Mexican cuisine is passed down. So that was something that I was really interested in exploring and looking at how that occurred for a lot of different Mexican chefs and Mexican people.
Right.
And Mexican cooks. But so I was looking for women specifically to interview. I was living in Austin, Texas. It was like 6 years ago. And I was in this coffee shop, whatever, sort of doing research and trying to make a list of women I wanted to interview. And then I came across Diana on Wikipedia, and I was like, who is this white woman who devoted her life to Mexican food? This doesn't really make sense. You know, it wasn't really part of my design of who I was looking for, but then I was like, she has to be part of this.
Right.
You know, if I'm not including her, she's an authority academically, you know, who would be really valuable to have be part of this. So then, but then I was like, okay, she lives in Michoacan in the middle of nowhere, presumably. And how do I find her? She's 91 years old, you know, like...
Everyone's always said, like, she's impossible to reach. Like, she just has lived there. She moved from England when she, like,
at
30?
She moved from England. She met her husband in Haiti in 1957. They fell madly in love, and he happened to be the New York Times correspondent to Mexico.
So
he invited her to come to Mexico City and live with him, and that's how she fell in love with Mexican food in the first place. So it's a very interesting story that she has, which is why I'm in the movie. But anyway...
Wow, it's so compelling. You could make a movie.
So anyway, I was like, God, she has to be part of this. How do I get in touch? And then I kind of gave up. I was like, well, I don't know how to find her. Gave up, closed the computer, drove to the bookstore like 20 minutes later in Austin called Book People. It's a great store. Yeah.
And shout out.
And then I looked at the marquee. This is literally 20 minutes later, guys. Looked at the marquee and it said, book signing with Diana Kennedy tomorrow.
What? I mean, come on.
And I was just
that's crazy.
Yeah, I was at that point, I was like, all right, I get it.
This is happening.
This is a cosmic joke.
That's
let's double down on this,
isn't
whatever.
Isn't that nuts?
So yeah, that was the beginning.
That's incredible.
It was sort of magical.
And now there's this amazing story and you're getting to tell her story as well, which is...
I'm honored to do that.
That's pretty cool.
It wasn't what I expected it to be, and it has been much better than I have ever imagined.
So. Congratulations.
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, congratulations. It's amazing. Okay, Chef, how am I doing? I already think I'd fail in your restaurant because you told me to cook all the onions, and I didn't. Don't know why. So I won't be applying for a job at Gran Electrica anytime soon.
Great. No worries.
So what do you do? You're going to toast the chilies, bring out more flavor.
Exactly. We're just kind of... wakening up the oils, if you will.
Okay.
Giving a little toastiness. And then I'll just continue doing that. We're going to add a little bit of cinnamon clove to
I love the warm spices. Here. And so a lot of people assume you have to do chocolate in it too, but the warm spices are pretty traditional.
Yeah, so exactly.
Okay.
They are.
Am I doing all of this? Do you know what I forget is that none of you are going to taste what I'm cooking, and I forget that. So I'm wanting to make it perfect.
No.
Like, oh, wait, you've already got your food in front of you. Should I go for it?
Perfect. Yeah, we'll do it.
we'll see. To taste. It does smell amazing as you're toasting the spices even more.
Adding on to the, and I think that's a good kind of factor you brought in about the chocolate.
Right.
Most people, when they think of mole, you're thinking of chocolate-based sauce.
Right.
Which isn't necessarily the case. I mean, the most iconic... mole, being the poblano, is going to have that chocolate, but most other ones do not.
Right.
And traditionally, the chocolate was drank as a drink. It's not necessarily, you know. But then they realized that you can add a lot of flavor utilizing that chocolate.
Absolutely. So is this the recipe that you use at the restaurant?
It
is.
Or is
this okay? How cool and special to be able to bring your own to it.
Yeah. It's been great.
Okay, so no chocolate in yours, but the three chilies toasted.
Exactly.
And do you have to hydrate them before you
puree
them?
No, because we're going to hydrate it in
the sauce
itself.
Okay.
Once those are kind of ready to roll, we're going to go ahead and season a little bit with the salt and then add our toasted chiles. And
what's it looking like?
This looks great.
Seasoning, generous, you'll see. He, chefs, salt brings out the flavor in everything. And so even when we're baking and doing pastry, we tell people to season. Yeah, want me to dump them in?
Please and thank you.
I can do this. I haven't made a sauce like this in years. Yeah. I'm excited. Ooh, sorry, you were trying to get an Instagram shot.
We'll just
okay, so this is
to cover. This is chicken stock we're gonna add to it.
Look at how rich that is.
We're just yeah.
Is it like triple chickens? Like you cook chickens in chicken stock,
pretty much,
and then
yeah. So you'd be surprised how much chicken go into this liquid to create that body.
Let's see how much. Let me push these down more.
Yeah, just so we can cover the chiles. So we're pretty much hydrating our chiles inside the chicken stock to add that flavor into everything.
Right.
We will be also toasting our nuts and seeds, pepitas primarily, like I was mentioning. And so I'll be doing that as that's kind of hydrating.
Okay. Do you want me to bring this up to a simmer?
Yes, please.
And then how long would you cook it if you weren't doing this in front of a live audience?
We're
going to
do this like just 15, 20 minutes.
Okay.
So as you can see, some moles take a considerable amount of time.
Right.
Such as a poblano or whatever other variants, really.
Right.
This one here is actually nice because it will cook up fairly quickly, and it's very flavorful, as you guys have had. I would say start to finish is probably going to be like a 45-minute time.
I don't think that's long for a mole. It's folklore. Yeah. That's right, right? You assume that it takes hours and hours.
Right,
but no.
Right. But, I mean, we're spreading the work, if you will, by toasting here, doing there. So we're doing a lot of that work in unison, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
But it's all gonna kind of come together fairly quickly.
Amazing.
Which is great.
Beautiful. Okay, I'm such a mom. I got you another bar mop because I don't want you to burn yourself.
Thank you.
I was like, those handles are hot.
Yeah, yeah.
If you get a chance, any of you, to check out Blanc Creatives, the cookware and tools back here. They're here from Charlottesville, Virginia. Handcrafted cookware, spoons, such beautiful pieces.
Yeah,
this would be a beautiful way to serve the entire dish.
Yeah, definitely.
Right?
Definitely.
So you're just gonna toast those pepitas.
Yeah, just kind of, once again, getting those oils reactivated.
Going.
And then we'll simmer in through with
and then you'll just dump them right into here?
Exactly.
Okay, great.
And you guys can't smell of it. Well, maybe you can.
Smell-o-vision?
Can, but as you're toasting all these different things and we're dumping it into the broth itself, you can smell them just kind of activating as far as the flavor goes and creating the depth,
it's kind of magical. That's what I think of when I think of mole, just like tons of depth of flavor, where you're like, as you eat, you're feeling, what's this, what's that? And other things start coming in. I love it.
Yep.
Elizabeth, were you inspired to cook much while you were working on this film?
No, because I was very busy finishing the movie. It got really pathetic by the end because I was just like waking up in the morning and realizing that I just stopped. I stopped cooking
right.
while I was making the movie, and it was kind of defeating because every like Q&A's people would be like, "So you must love to cook and be great at it, right?" And I'm like, "Well,
no,
I do love it, but I want to get better at it. Right. I think I'm okay."
Oh, you're.
All right. But no,
he better say you are.
I want to learn from people like you guys. You know, I think that it's like the doing it. That's what it is, you know.
Right.
Doing the movie taught me how to make the movie, and doing the cooking
teaches you how to do it.
Cook.
How are you describing to me, how did you say it when you were like, we all have to bring something different to it, and how you cook without measurements, but you said something so nice about, you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
It was kind of talking about making it your own, and if you don't do that, and you like follow the recipe exactly. Right.
Yeah, exactly. So it's, I mean, we were talking about also nostalgia in general with some of these, that following a recipe is great for replicating, but when you're doing it, you're tasting, you're seasoning, you're kind of feeling the ingredients as you go along, and
mm-hmm.
you get a better sense of what you're creating, and not just for yourself, but for those around you that are going to be eating and kind of enjoying it, hopefully, with you.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's, you know, that I think that's the beauty, and kind of going back with, you know, the grandmothers or even just anyone that cooks. There's certain things that you're not necessarily going to divulge to everyone, but, you know, there's guidelines, and I think that that's it with cooking.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Have you changed this much from what you learned? Has your recipe evolved much?
I think every time we make it, it's slight variance, but it's, you know, we try to keep it uniform.
Yeah.
So it's
in a restaurant, people start to expect consistency for sure.
But you definitely, everyone has a different palate and a different flavor profile. So, you know, just slight variances, but it's always kind of consistent for the most part.
That's good to know.
Yeah.
I can't wait to try it.
I'm going to go and put these
guys in. Okay, go for it. Oh, he doesn't even need the second towel. Whatever. Okay. Right. Thank you.
Yep.
Chef, can I ask you where you grew up?
I grew up in Salinas. That's a little north from here, or south from here, sorry.
Yeah.
And that's kind of like just this agricultural town for the most part.
Right.
We had a lot of exposure to the big companies like Andy Boy, Man Packing, like all those kind of Ocean Mist,
mm-hmm.
agriculture-wise. And so, yeah, I grew up kind of in that region.
Yeah. But you have family from Mexico.
Yes, Culiacán, Sinaloa particularly.
And for people who don't understand the geography of Mexico, where is
so it's
large?
A coastal region is the west side of Mexico,
okay.
Kind of the northern side. And so that's kind of what we're looking at as far as, like, it's very similar to California, really, as far as, like, the shape and also what's available. But, yeah, that's where...
What's the food style like in Culiacán?
A lot of seafood, as I was mentioning. Definitely wheat-based products instead of corn.
Oh, wow. Is that a northern thing?
It is.
Or just, yeah. Wow.
It
okay.
is. Yeah, so up in the north, we use a little bit more of...
Yeah, it's more northern style, right?
Exactly. Yeah.
Sesame.
And a lot of seafood, like I was mentioning, I think.
Right.
Twice, right?
Now, when did you start cooking as a profession?
That was actually coming... I'm thinking,
you're like, when I was 12.
No, I mean, I... Thank you. Uh-huh. I always did cook for my brothers growing up.
You did?
Yeah. I mean, it probably wasn't the greatest, but I
no,
did
No, but
try.
You just... You loved it? Or
yeah,
it was
definitely.
Just as felt to you?
Yeah, no, it just... It felt right.
Right.
Yeah, and then...
Amazing.
Yeah, just coming back after the Marine Corps, actually. I was kind of not sure, and then I went back to cooking.
Oh my gosh.
Started all up again.
Amazing.
Yeah, so I've been doing that since.
Congratulations.
Been happy since.
I think you can share with me what's next, but I'm laughing because you've been the executive chef at the restaurant since it opened about how long ago? A year and a half?
Yeah.
Yeah, and you had a baby the same week?
Yeah, the week prior.
Oh, the week prior. Nothing like a newborn
yeah.
and opening a restaurant. I cannot imagine. I can't imagine. So
yeah, that was
a monumental time in your life, right?
Definitely.
Yeah, that was funny.
Fun nights.
Fun nights. That's one way of putting it. I don't recall them being fun all the time. So what have we got here?
So we're going to add a little bit of apple cider vinegar as well as agave.
Right? I turned it up too high.
Yeah, no worries.
Do you always use agave?
We do,
as a sweetener?
Yeah. It's a...
Which would you like me to add?
Let's do like a tablespoon.
Does it make you nervous to have somebody else trying to cook your food?
No,
you're like, don't
no.
do it that way. He's so nice. You can fix it. You can change anything.
Yeah,
how much agave?
We'll do this about
same.
The same, yes, please.
Good?
Yeah, perfect.
Okay. All right. Said I'm just here to help. Okay, terrific. So this is going to balance out the acid you like against the sweet.
Exactly.
And kind of play against the bitter of the chili some?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we just have this pretty little chili soup happening, swimming around. I don't know if you saw, too, we added tomatoes. Were those peeled tomatoes?
Those
well?
Were peeled. You don't necessarily need to peel them, but I
right.
found that it creates a nice kind of like velvety after flavor taste.
Nice.
A little less work on the backside to
and then,
it down.
So this would simmer for a few more minutes,
yeah.
probably 20, 25 in a real world, but we can always cheat it if you want,
yeah,
or you
definitely,
can
definitely.
Share
I
the duck piece
no,
of things.
We're definitely at that point. We'll go ahead and just puree this guy up.
Okay.
And, you know what? Why don't we let it simmer?
Okay, we can, we'll, right? We'll work on the
yeah,
duck
we'll the
while
duck
we do
since
that.
We're on
okay,
that note.
All right, we can. How is it, everyone? How's the bite that you had? Delicious.
Yeah. Thank you. And so.
We'll let that simmer. Yeah. And so, what do you do with the duck?
So, the duck itself is bean confit.
Mm-hmm.
We're gonna go ahead and just cook it in its own fat. We'll put it into
yes, please.
This guy here.
Okay. All three?
Yes, please. And then we're just going to bring this up to a simmer.
Okay.
And cover it, like I was mentioning, with a little more fat on it.
Oh,
while it's heating up, we're going to go ahead and add some aromatics. And I'll explain those
into the duck fat?
Yes.
Wow.
So the great thing about fat, it's going to cover.
It's gorgeous.
Yeah.
It is gorgeous.
The great thing about the fat is that it carries flavors. I'll do that. I'll wait for the
train to come up. This duck was already cooked.
Yes.
And you can chill it down, right? Or you could store it in the duck fat as well.
Yes, yes, okay. yes.
So, and then bring it back up.
Exactly. So we're just going to add a couple of the
ooh,
same
yeah.
flavors.
Okay, cool.
To kind of reinforce those flavor profiles.
Right.
We're going to add a little bit of chiles.
Okay.
Just like three of those.
These
are actually the moritas. I would generally use guajillo, but I got rid of those guys earlier.
Whoops.
Just as a reference. We do have some bay leaves. We're going to do some cinnamon, as well as, where are you? Epazote. Epazote is...
I love this. Can't wait to see it.
I'd say probably one of the most iconic Mexican herbs, if you will. It's used... It's used in a lot of braises, stews and stuff like that. It gives you a nice kind of herbal quality to most of your dishes. It's kind of just mellow everything out.
Do you ever serve it raw, or do you always?
I personally don't like
the flavor
of it.
It's really strong, isn't it?
When it's young, yeah, it is fairly potent. Mm-hmm. When it's young, it's not bad. But once this comes up to a simmer, we're going to go ahead and toss it in the oven and let it cook for about 2.5 hours.
Oh, wow.
And we're good. Epazote. Yeah, epazote.
Gorgeous. This would go straight into the oven for a couple hours.
Yes.
Okay,
yes,
and then...
I have a quick question, Chef.
Sure.
How do you compare the flavor profiles between epazote and hoja santa?
So with epazote, it would be... Well, let's start with hoja santa.
Back into this.
It's easier that way. With hoja santa, you're getting more of an anise quality. It's more herbaceous in that sense. It's kind of like a licorice base almost.
Yeah.
Whereas this, if you smell it, it's almost like if it was kind of like a tire, kind of tarry, but it's got more of a pungent.
Tobacco tire.
Yeah, exactly.
Something like that.
You know more than you're leading on to. Look at her.
I'm a nerd about food. I can't cook very well, but I know
things matter,
about it.
Yeah. Right? Yeah.
Exactly. And I mean, the great thing about hoja santa is you can use that to wrap a lot of things. So that's... You know, great
tamales.
Quality of it. Exactly.
Yeah.
Great quality for that. So.
So if you, is there a dish that kind of epitomizes your type of Mexican cooking, or is that impossible to?
I would say, it's
impossible. It's too hard.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A lot in that sense.
Right.
Not sure.
This is probably pretty amazing just because this is your own take on it. Mm-hmm. Okay. So with the magic of fast forwarding, we would pretend that this is done and let's puree it. Okay. We'll do that. I'll just move it on over for you. This cool blender. So this will be a chef's tip from both of us. Putting hot liquids in here, not always the safest thing, right? You can blow the top off a blender. So I don't know if you're gonna like take the plastic part off. Or there's a way to vent it, just to be really careful. So how much do you want to put in?
About half of it.
Okay.
So we don't overload this thing.
So I was gonna say, I'll just move it right here so I don't spill it as well. Let's scoop a little out. Oh, I can probably do it like this. I'm going to get too much liquid, though, right? Do you mind? Oh, look at him with his tongs, tweezers.
Fancy little.
Fancy chef tools. You just happen to have them on you. Oh, my gosh.
I think that's plenty.
It seems like the city and town of Napa has been so receptive to your restaurant as well. Where is it? Is it right here? If you're locals.
Yeah, it's actually right across the street, just about. I mean, we're right on Main.
Wow.
Oh, it's... Five-minute walk? Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that's terrific.
We walked here, actually, this morning. So.
That is not a bad commute. I'll take it.
Not at all.
Well, that's cool. So it's got this little slit. That's perfect, so we can do that. I'm going to let you do it.
All right. Well, we'll figure out how to use this. All right, so we're just going to...
I'm not very nice.
Just going to puree this guy up so it's nice and smooth.
There we go. And by the time you're done with it, it would be totally smooth, homogenous.
Yeah.
I guess I could look on the plate and see what we're looking for, right? Oh, that's beautiful. And these tortillas? You made these? Oh, I just brought these tortillas with me today.
Yeah, we actually, so in our restaurant, we do make tortillas. We do make tortillas on a daily basis.
Yeah.
Those were made today, this morning, prior to coming here. So
get much fresher than that.
Yeah, I mean... We're pretty much utilizing and making everything away from the can, so it's keeping it traditional in that sense too.
Yeah, exactly. Oh wow. So can I taste?
Yeah, of course.
What's the seasoning going to be like on this? You're like, no, you can't. I'm always curious because we all focus on tasting as we go because you can always add more salt, but it's really hard to take it away.
Yeah.
Mm.
Here, I'll taste with you because.
It's got some heat to it.
It does. We're going to tone it down with that agave. Yep.
But I like it. Wow, did theirs have that much heat?
No, we turned it out the gun.
That's what happens when I shove them all in there and I'm not paying attention to measurements. But it's delicious.
Yeah, thank you.
Wow, so I would never, I mean, I don't make duck confit all the time. I love this pairing, but what else would you serve your mole with traditionally?
Depending on, turkey.
Turkey.
For instance, if we're not talking necessarily the pipián, like, well, right now we're featuring one with the turkey breast. It's going with the poblano, very traditional pairing.
Beautiful.
Of the two, the poultry with the mole. You can actually do, touching on the various types of moles, we have,
delicious.
Oaxaca has seven that they like to talk about that are very, very iconic for Oaxaca in general. And, you know, one of those is using green mole with fish, which you wouldn't think to like dredge it with a lot of sauce, but you know, it does work. That's utilizing that hoja santa we were talking about earlier.
Right.
So, yeah, it's very versatile. It can be used in anything. Just can be a sauce that accompanies essentially anyone.
Anything you like. Oh, it is absolutely delicious. My tongue is still on fire from that one, but I love so good. But it's absolutely spectacular. Yeah, so good. What do you think of the wine with it now that we know what we're drinking? Good combination? No, we're getting mixed reviews. I think it's kind of, what do you think? Did you get to try your own food?
Oh, I have, yeah. It's great.
What would you do? What would you serve with this? Would you go tequila? Do you make great margaritas at the restaurant?
Cerveza. Mezcal.
Mezcal.
I would say mezcal.
Smoky. That sounds amazing.
I would definitely go with mezcal. It'd help with the fattiness. Yeah, no, I mean, can't go wrong, really.
You can't go wrong. Yeah, I'm super happy with this pairing as well, but
maybe
mezcal would be amazing.
Madre Quiche?
Say again, I'm sorry?
What kind of mezcal would you serve?
Well, for me, I like...
Tobala?
Tobala's great.
Espadín.
Espadín's awesome. Maybe Oaxaca. But I don't know. It's hard to say. It's a personal preference, too, right?
Options. Choices. And it's having a moment. Mezcal is certainly having its moment to be recognized, like tequila,
true.
I feel, you know?
Yeah.
So
it's hot.
So
right
good.
Now.
Definitely.
What were you going to ask?
No, I was just going to say one thing about the tortillas. I think the biggest defining moment in my experience of eating Mexican food, and when I meet people and they're like, I don't know that much about Mexican food, or then they come to Mexico or whatever and they try real masa and they try real tortillas, that tends to be like a shifting point for a lot of people's understanding around Mexican food. Because
right.
I think it's like you can taste flavor profiles, you can taste all sorts of other things, but this very basic element that's so essential, it's so important for it to be well made and to be made correctly. And that, like when you eat like, sorry, shitty tortilla, you know, like something
you
that's like,
you can say it.
Yeah, so it's just like clearly maseca, like, you know, and maseca, if you know, is sort of like the industrialized version of masa, which has a lot of genetically modified ingredients in it, and it's just not
good for you.
It's the fundamental difference is that real masa, correct me if I'm wrong on anything here, but real masa is like a complete protein. It's like it's meant to be nutrient rich.
Right.
Whereas, you know, white tortillas, corn
not
tortillas
so
made out of maseca are actually not good for you at all. So when you're making real masa and good masa, it tastes that way because it's nourishing your body. Your body is desiring it, and it tastes amazing anyway. So I think that's a huge indicator of a restaurant and a chef
the
who
quality
knows what
of
they're
the
doing
food.
To understand that that's sort of the heart of everything. Sin maíz, no hay país, right?
Yes.
So good. Yeah. Oh, my gosh. Well, I am so grateful that we had this pairing today to bring you both here. Thank you so much. And I want to ask, does anybody have any questions before we wrap it up and send you off to drink more wine and watch more films? Hi. Yeah.
It's Gran Electrica. Yes, Gran Electrica.
Gran Electrica, which is right behind us,
yes,
right?
Yes.
What's the address? 1313 Main Street. And I was just told to deliver a very important message to hold on to your wine glasses for intermission, because you can go from here and they're pouring all kinds of wine, so you can continue to enjoy it. She's asking why he chose the name Gran Electrica for the restaurant.
So the name came from a very famous piece from an artist named Jose Guadalupe Posada. And he was most famous for his Day of the Dead sketches and his political activism. So one of his most famous pieces was called La Gran Calavera Electrica, The Great Electric Skeleton.
Got it.
We loved that. We loved his work. And in fact, if you come to our restaurants, you'll notice one of our major design features is our wallpaper featuring his work, but in the style of all of our local landmarks. So in Brooklyn, we started it with all the landmarks surrounding our Brooklyn location.
So cool.
And here in the Napa Valley, you'll find the wine train on there and Robert Mondavi's winery and a whole bunch of other sort of local iconic landmarks.
Amazing. Thank you so much, all of you. Thanks for being here and spending time with us this afternoon. And I hope you'll come back tomorrow. And I hope you'll go see the film. Thank you. Way to go, Chef. Thank you.
Thank you.
That's great.